Sunday morning.
Should we move this mic?
Yes.
It's gotta go, but I'm not. Okay, now move that.
There we go.
It's on the chair.
He's out, right?
It's over there on the chair.
I mean, he has.
Oh. Is yours up there? Oh, okay.
Yes, very cool. Sorry, really not melody there.
Who lives in the 60s?
No. No, he does. Have you heard Disturbed's cover? Sounds the same. It's actually pretty good. But like Disturbed's.
Never ate that much of a comedy song.
I mean, the song's already melancholy, but it's like just too much.
Turn it. I got it. It's fine. It just didn't do what I wanted it to do.
Today's Glen Ellen's clear out day, so don't want to get stuff from people's curbs. Today's the day to do it. And I think they do it every other year now. And my sister bought my mom's house, so this afternoon. Anything that's not claimed by anybody is not. But yes, it is a dumpster dive hair list today. Just that we do get a lot of snow. I know.
Get out there.
No.
I
Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to worship. Welcome as we gather in God's house among God's people. My name is Jill Terpstra, and I'm the pastor here at First Church of Lombard, and I'm so blessed to be with you together in worship today. As we listen to our prelude, I invite you to use this time as a time to center yourselves and prepare yourselves for worship.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to First Church of Lombard, United Church of Christ. Welcome however you are joining us for worship today, here in the sanctuary or online. We seek to be mindful of the different worldviews among us. Therefore, we strive to celebrate and respect those differences, which can include, but are not limited to, sexual orientation, gender identity, race, ethnicity, different abilities, mental health, socioeconomic status, immigration status, cultural background, age, or experience. We desire to learn and grow together as we to love, support, and seek justice for people of all kinds as an open and affirming and just peace congregation. Children in preschool through fifth grade begin worship with their families and will be dismissed to Sunday school shortly. For parents who need a quiet, calm place to go with smaller children, the nursery is available across from the main office, and usher can direct you if needed. The audio of the service, as well as activities for infants and toddlers, are accessible in the nursery, but the room is not staffed. Please fill out the ministry pad in the red plastic folders and pass it along to others in your pew. So there's one in each pew. If you are visiting with us, we'd appreciate it if you would leave us your name, address, email, and/or phone number so we can contact you this week and let you know how happy we are that you worshiped with us today. On this Music Appreciation Sunday, we'd like to thank all our musicians for everything they do, with a special thanks to our Director of Music Ministry, Jeanette Rodriguez. I'd also like to throw in a special thank you to our director of children's music, and that's Lawrence Underwood. So,
yeah.
big part of my ministry here is with working directly with him, Lawrence. Join us next Sunday as we congratulate the youth who will be joining the church through confirmation. We are proud of them and their families for their dedication to our rigorous 2-year confirmation program. We also thank the adult and youth leaders who guided the students on this journey. A group from First Church will march in Lombard's Lilac Parade on Sunday, May 19th at 1:30 p.m. All ages and abilities are welcome. A car will be available for those who need to ride along. The parade is a great way to represent our church to the community and to advertise for the Pride Fest coming up on June 2nd. Please indicate your interest in being in the parade on the sign-up sheet on the bulletin in the foyer and mark your calendars for Sunday, May 19th. Now, if you will please stand and greet each other for the passing of the peace. Join in the opening song, Lord, I Want to Be a Christian. In just a moment, I'm going to have you join me for the opening prayer, but I wanted to let you know, Linda Wilson came up and let me know that the Women's Fellowship raised over $2,000 at the rummage sale this weekend. So with that in mind, let's join together in our opening prayer of thanks. Creating God, we are grateful for the hope that you offer to us and all creation. Prune us so that we may have a cleansed heart. Help us to grow your garden of love. Water our despair so it can be transformed into your hope. Feed our minds so that all may glean from your wisdom. Nurture our spirits so that we can become more fruitful in our lives. Give us new life, we pray. Amen. You may be seated. At this time, children in preschool through fifth grade are dismissed to Sunday school. A teacher will be on hand to guide them to their class. No, it's not me today. Sunday school students should be picked up by a parent or another responsible adult at 11:30 a.m. at the resource room, which is located on the lower level.
Our scripture reading for today is from John 15, verses 1 through 8. Last week we heard Jesus describing himself as the good shepherd, and this week we hear him describing himself, well, God as the vine and us as the branches. So hear these words. I am the true vine, and my Father is the vine grower. He removes every branch in me that bears no fruit. Every branch that bears fruit, he prunes to make more fruit. You have already been cleansed by the word that I have spoken to you. Abide in me as I abide in you. Just as the branch cannot bear fruit by itself unless it abides in the vine, neither can you unless you abide in me. I am the vine, and you are the branches. Those who abide in me and I in them bear much fruit, because apart from me, you can do nothing. Whoever does not abide in me is thrown away like a branch and withers. Such branches are gathered, thrown into the fire and burned. If you abide in me and my words abide in you, ask for whatever you wish, and it will be done for you. My Father is glorified by this, that you bear much fruit and become my disciples. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. God, we thank you for gathering us together this day. I ask that the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable in your sight. For you, O God, are our rock, our strength, and our redeemer. Amen. The house that I grew up in had a grapevine that grew along the fence behind the house. I knew it was a grapevine because it had those large, distinctive leaves. I also knew that it was a grapevine because in the fall, my father would cut down the long branches that were spilling over the fence into our neighbor's yard, and then my mom would wind them together into wreaths, similar to what's up here, and she would decorate them with bows and trinkets and give them to friends and neighbors. And while I always remember the grapevine being there, I don't ever remember it having any grapes on it. I'm not sure if it had grapes on it when my parents first moved into our house, or maybe there were grapes and I never remembered them, but I think I would have remembered them because I love to make mud pies, and grapes would have been perfect in mud pies. I only ever remember tearing up the leaves and adding them for color into my mud pies. But I do remember my dad trying to keep those grapevines at bay. He spent hours and hours in the yard ripping out the branches that were intertwined in the fence or growing up the trunk of the evergreen or creeping out into the yard. It was a constant battle to keep the grapevine pruned. In order for grapevines to grow and flourish, and not just grapevines, but most plants, they need to be well taken care of in order to do well. In vineyards, grapevines are trained to go up a central trunk, and then that they are pruned so that they can go out on long wires that you see when you see vineyards or places where they grow grapes. If you want to grow grapes in your backyard and not in a fancy vineyard, you still need to prune your grapevines because grapes grow on the new wood. You have to get rid of all of the old wood so that the grapes can grow. And I'm told that when it comes to pruning grapes, the most common mistake that people make is not pruning enough. When pruning grapes, you need to cut off as much of the old growth as possible in order to encourage new growth. And the new growth is where the fruit is produced. Pruning away the old growth causes the plant to focus its energy on the fruit instead of on the branches that reach out. Also, in looking into vineyards this week, I learned that vine growers purposely stress the vines in order to produce better fruit. Vineyard growers carefully monitor how much water a plant is getting, and when possible, they actually deprive the plant of water so that it can go into something called water stress. When the plant feels threatened, it focuses its energy on producing fruit and not on creating more branches or shoots going out, so that the grapes can get those nutrients and resources. The lack of water also helps the individual grapes to be smaller, which I'm told makes a better wine. So now that you know all of this, you can try your hand at some backyard grapes so you can make your own wine. But the reason, of course, that I'm telling you this is because Jesus talks in today's scripture about a vineyard and grapes and vines and a vine grower. In our passage for today, Jesus says that he is the vine and we are the branches. And to set the context for Jesus saying this, he is saying this on the very last night of his life when he and the disciples are gathered together for the Last Supper. And I can imagine Jesus knowing how things are going to end and that he's going to be leaving the disciples soon. And I can almost imagine him as they're sitting at the Last Supper, and maybe there's just a few drops of wine in the bottom of the glasses, and he thinks, you know, I am like the vine and you are like the branches. And then he says to the disciples, rise and be on your way. I am the true vine, and my Father is the vine grower. Jesus says that he is the vine, and that God is the vine grower, and we are the branches extending out from the vine, expected to produce fruit. And Jesus tells us that God is the vine grower who prunes the branches so that they can produce even more fruit. The scripture says God cuts off every branch that doesn't bear grapes, and every branch that is grape-bearing, he prunes back so that it will bear even more. You are already pruned back by the message I have spoken. So in this analogy, we are the branches in need of pruning so that we can bear even more fruit. And what might the fruits be that we are trying to grow? Well, in Galatians, the fruits of the Spirit are joy, love, peace, forbearance, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. The Message version of Galatians puts these fruits this way, saying, but what happens when we live God's way? He brings gifts into our lives, much the same way that fruit appears in an orchard. Things like affection for others, exuberance about life, serenity. We develop a willingness to stick with things and a sense of compassion in the heart and a conviction that a basic holiness permeates things and people. We find ourselves involved in loyal commitments, not needing to force our way in life, able to marshal and direct our energies wisely. Remember, Jesus is comparing himself to a vine and the disciples as the branches on the very night before he dies. I imagine that Jesus wanted to convey a sense of urgency to the disciples. He wanted the disciples to know that even though things are going to be difficult, once he is not there, they will still be connected to him. And he also is reminding them to focus on the things that are most important. He seems to be saying to the disciples, if you focus on those very most important things, the fruits of ministry will grow and you will stay connected to me. But in order for those fruits to grow and become full fruit, some pruning needs to happen in our lives. The unuseful or withering things need to be cleared away. The shoots that are going off into the wrong direction need to be cut back, and the tendrils that are reaching too far need to be guided back toward the vine. I don't know about you, but I don't really want that kind of pruning, because pruning hurts. Sure, I'd like the dead stuff and the unimportant things to be removed from my life, but couldn't God just do a little trim here or there, not a full pruning? But that's not what Jesus is saying. In order for us to bear healthy fruit, parts of our lives, whether they look healthy on the outside or not, might need to be pruned away. Things that might be meaningful to us might have to go away so that other things can grow. In gardening, the practice of pruning can leave a shrub or plant looking like all hope is lost. It can look pretty much dead. But a few weeks later, with time and rest and sunshine and water, the plant can become strong and healthy and flourish. And that's because of the pruning, not in spite of the pruning. The science of gardening even uses special terms to describe this kind of pruning. They call it restorative or rejuvenating pruning. It's necessary in order for the plant to thrive. The drastic cutting back of a living thing causes the plant to come back with more vigor and strength and beauty. The same plant that once appeared hopeless can thrive after being pruned. The same is true for us. When we are faced with life's losses and challenges, it's very easy to feel as though we are being aggressively pruned. Whether it's illness or isolation, separation, loss of those we love, these events can make us feel like we have been cut off from the source of life as we know it. It may seem improbable or even impossible that any beauty will ever emerge from such a season of pruning. But allowing for and even striving for the same principles applied to botanical pruning can eventually lead a person whose spirit is wounded to eventually into a time of growth. In the final moments with the disciples, Jesus also used this analogy to convey something else to the disciples, not just the importance of pruning and bearing fruit, but he also wanted them to know that no matter what happens, they will always be connected to the vine. Not only can the branches bear fruit, cannot bear fruit without being connected to the vine, but they will not be able to grow at all if they are disconnected from the vine. Jesus is saying this right before he is about to leave them, so he is saying that even though he won't physically be with them, Jesus wants the disciples to know that they can still be connected to him. And this is the promise that Jesus made to the disciples, and it is the same promise that is made to each of us. The promise that no matter what happens, Jesus is connected to us. The promise that even though Jesus isn't physically with us, we are connected to Jesus, and Jesus will hold on to us like a vine holding on to its branches. Jesus reiterates this promise a few verses later beyond what I read when he says, "You did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you to go out and bear fruit, fruit that will last, and so that whatever you ask in my name, the Father will give you. This is my commandment, love each other." When we show love, we, the branches, are bearing the fruit that comes from the strength that we get from the vine. And the vine actually needs us. The vine can't spread out into the world without the branches. So the branches have to spread out into the world, spreading and bearing the fruits of love as they go. The vine cannot spread the fruits on its own. It needs the branches to go out and spread its fruit and have more room to grow. So as we try to discern the things in our lives that need to stay and what need to go, remember your deep connection with God, a connection that is strong and nourishing and life-giving. The winter might be painful and barren, but if we remain in God, in due time, we will produce fruit that remains. Just hang on. Amen. I now invite you to stand as you are able as we sing "Abide With Me." You may be seated. At this time, you're invited to think about how you may stay connected to the vine by giving of yourself. You may give on our website. You may give in the box in the back. You may mail or drop off a check to the church. There are also green cards in the pews that you can scan as a way to give. We are so grateful for all the ways that you give, and especially grateful for the way that you give of your time by volunteering for the many ministries here. This past week, as we mentioned, the rummage sale, many of you were here. We also had our Earth Day event. We also had a planting for Earth Day. We had our pizza fundraiser last weekend. So without all of you, none of those things could have happened. So thank you for all the ways that you contribute to the ministries here at First Church. For our time of sharing, I will share the joys and concerns that I received this week. Know that you can fill out a card in the back, and as a way to make sure that those are included in our prayers, you can also email me or submit them on our website. Vito Alfano asked for your prayers. He went to the ER, and in the process of checking what he went into the ER for, they discovered he has a heart issue. So he is thankful that for the discoveries and prayers for his treatment and moving forward. So we lift him up in prayer. We also, as we're getting to the end of the year, we lift up students, teachers, and staff as they're finishing up, and college students that are traveling back home and for the transition from college back to home life. We pray for students and their parents. As is our tradition at First Church, I will read the names of those that lost their lives due to homicide in the Chicago area. And while these names might not be known to us, they are known to God and to their families. So we think of Jemiah Triplett, Luis Huesca, Darnell Shanks, one unidentified woman, and eight unidentified men. O God, hold them and their families in your arms. Whether we say our prayer requests out loud or only hold them in our hearts, we know God hears our prayers. So I invite us to take our time as we enter into our prayer song, singing together, Alleluia. God, you are the vine of life, and in your branches we are nestled, taking shelter and sustenance in the shade of your strength. With thanksgiving, we celebrate the growth and hope that we have found in placing our roots in you. For in life you nourish us, and your spirit encourages us to reach our full potential in the gifts that we have been given, that through offering them ourselves, others may know your love. God, we ask you to make us more than sour grapes or unripe olives. In the hardships of the world, may we look beyond the bitter divisions in order to find your love at the core of our relationships. May we seek to work together to see what we all have in common, and that we might grow to be people of respect and trust. God, may our branches bow with the weight of the fruit that you have given to us, and may we take that fruit and share it with others. Help us to look beyond our own needs and to recognize those who are hungry for food, love, or justice. May we offer others the shelter needed under the weight of your branches, so that they may find a rest from the cold and darkness, the hatred and loneliness of this world. Instead, may your Spirit enable us all to value the gifts and talents and gifts and fruits that you offer to all your children. God, may our leaves soak up your light, so that when we meet those who are worn down with illness, loneliness, grief, abandonment, may the light of your presence shine in the encounters they have with others and with us, so that all might know your compassion. God, we lift up those that are known to us and those concerns that are heaviest on our hearts now in silence. O God, you are the gardener of our life. We invite you to trim and shape us for your purposes, and we place all these prayers in your hands as we pray together the prayer that Jesus taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. I now invite you to stand as you are able as we sing Sent Forth by God's Blessing.
As you go into this week, may you remember that the winter may be barren and painful, but if we remain in God in due time, we will produce fruit. And now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you now and forevermore. Go in peace. Please be seated for our postlude.
Nobody's here, but I need to know.
You want those back?
Yeah.